World Health Organization just declare this a global health emergency?
The thing we're concerned about is the transmission from person to person to person.
A shortage of toilet paper, hand sanitizers, and soap.
Vermont's governor added new restrictions to the current stay-at-home order.
I know these are not easy times. Yesterday, I issued the stay-at-home, stay-safe order. I need you to stay home. Doing so will save lives. It's just that simple. We must all do our part to slow the spread of this deadly virus.
I am officially declaring a national emergency.
Being in the hospital for so long, being in the isolation, it was really hard.
People in Burlington, Montpelier, and Hanover, New Hampshire take action following the death of George Floyd in Minneapolis.
Hundreds of protesters gathered in Battery Park in Burlington on Saturday evening, calling for change.
We turn now to Chicago, where violent protests erupted early this morning. Hundreds swept through the Magnificent Mile and upscale shopping district there, as you know, looting stores and clashing with police.
After 9 months of fear, loneliness, and limits on our freedom that we never could have imagined, finally, some good news. The longed-for vaccine suddenly becoming a tangible reality, Pfizer's found to be 90% effective.
Merry Christmas, everyone. In fact, welcome to Christmas Eve, Essex Alliance Church 2020. Now, you know that you're not at the church, but as you can tell by this picture in the background behind me, I'm not at Essex Alliance Church. We're filming at this beautiful log cabin home, which has been made available to us. Our new friend, Dino May, grew up in Essex. He heard that we were looking for a place to film our Christmas Eve service. And immediately he said, you can use my house and my home. In fact, I want to donate it to you for your use in honor of my niece, Tasha. And we found out Tasha is a church family member at Essex Alliance. So we get to be here in this wonderful place. And thank you for inviting us into your home on this Christmas Eve. We started just a moment ago. You saw a bunch of video shots and pictures of our lives, all the events and things that have happened in this past year, 2020. Been anxious, some anxious times, some unsure times, but the great thing about Christmas is it has a way of calming us. It has a way of putting everything else aside, and it brings us back to remembering the Christmas story. And when we do that, we find peace and we find hope. And our hope tonight, in these few minutes that we have together, is that these moments would be redemptive moments. That you'd find a quiet moment, gather the family, maybe it's just yourself, and sit down on the couch and quietly just reflect in these couple of moments the incredible Christmas story of Jesus coming to this earth and celebrating this incredible story. Let me offer a prayer before we begin. Father, thank you for every person that's tuning in and watching, regardless of where they're at. For some people, their houses are filled with people and a lot of noise. Other people are sitting by themselves and it's pretty quiet. But regardless of the circumstance, would you remind us of the hope that we have in Jesus? Regardless of how we feel, regardless of this past year, we come to this moment where we need a redemptive moment. We need a moment where we're recharged. We need a moment where we rediscover hope. We need a moment again where in this quietness of the moment, we find our hearts being securely held by you. We find hope and we find faith and we find trust. That's what we hope to have happen tonight in these moments together. Whether we sing along with the worship team, whether we just sit back and listen, may we enjoy these moments tonight as we celebrate your birth. We give this night, we give all of this time to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let earth receive her King. Merry Christmas. I want to share the Christmas story with you. I'll be reading from Luke chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger.
Well, there's no question 2020 has been quite a year. You know, through the years of advertising, Christmas carols, Christmas cards, a common theme has always been home for Christmas. But admittedly, this year it's got a whole new twist. This year it's, locked in at home at Christmas, stuck at home in Christmas. or maybe home alone, but what would be even worse would be alone at home at Christmas. It's been a tough year, but stick with me for just a couple of moments. You know, one of the things that I see and sense in most of our lives is our lives are basically made up of two key elements. We run our lives based on our hopes, and we run our lives based on our fears. We have all sorts of things we hope for and all the things that we fear. And you can go back, and I don't have the time to do this, but you can go back in time and look at your own life, and you'll find that our lives are pretty much governed and marked by our hopes and our fears throughout life. And COVID comes along, and on top of the fact that we already have difficulties in life, COVID just makes it worse. And what we've dealt with in this past year just complicates things. And what I know on this Christmas Eve is that some of you know that all too well already. For some of you in this past couple of months, you've lost loved ones. Some of you are dealing with sickness in your home, or either for you or for a family member. Lost jobs, trying to pay bills. I mean, those are things that happen already in life. And then COVID comes along and just makes things worse. Our hopes and our fears. And that's really our life in a nutshell. But I want to talk about some of that tonight, and I want to give you a different perspective, and I want to really give you some hope that you'll find with the Christmas story. You know, the truth of it is that fear is part of our human condition. Fear is a part of who we are and dealing with our fears. If you go back and look in the Bible, you'll find that over and over again, whenever God was speaking to people, he always had to start with fear not or don't be afraid. In fact, the Christmas story itself is one of these great stories that we can relate to, because all through the story, you have people who are afraid. Mary is told, hey, don't be afraid. Even though you're going to be carrying the Son of God, don't be afraid. To Joseph, don't be afraid to take her as your wife, even though she's pregnant and she's never slept with a man. But you're going to take her on as your wife. And then, of course, we've got our shepherds that we're told to fear not. In fact, I think about the shepherds often because I think I relate best to them. I see them just minding their own business, doing their thing, doing the things that they do every day, taking care of the sheep. And all of a sudden, they find themselves in the middle of that field on that night, and they were terrified and they were frightened. And in some moments, doesn't it feel like all you have is fear? And that fear can overwhelm us because it's part of our condition. Let's be really transparent with each other. This past year has had some pretty anxious moments. And I'm not talking about you now. I'm talking about me. Moments when I didn't know what the future held. Those early days of COVID where everyone was frightened and so was I. And some anxious moments. I think about the church and what the church is going to look like in the future. Not just our church, but any church. And the different dynamic that's going to be there. Will it ever be the same again? Every time I see my grandkids wearing masks bothers me, and it scares me sometimes. You see, it doesn't matter who you are, fear and scare can overwhelm us. Being scared can overwhelm us. Now, I know I'm the pastor. I'm supposed to be the beacon of hope. And, you know, generally, I'm a pretty hopeful guy. But it doesn't matter how hopeful you are. It doesn't matter how up you are. There are moments in life that tend to scare us. Back in March, when COVID was just starting, we were all in lockdown and we didn't know much about this virus. My wife, Diane, got very sick as I've ever seen her. And she didn't get better, she got worse. And so the doctor had told her, you need to go in and get a test for COVID. And of course, this was in the early days. I couldn't go with her. She had to go by herself. She had to pull into the doctor's office, stay in the car, keep your hands on the wheel. And then when they came out to give her the test, they came out, of course, in a full hazmat suit, just right out of a scene from the movie Outbreak. And it was scary and it was frightening. She came home and she said it was so bothersome to go through that. And on top of that, she was sick and she wasn't getting better. So one point is we're watching television, we're watching the news, we're seeing what's happening in New York and other places. And being scared was a reality and fear sets in. So at one point, she put a little suitcase together. Because if she had to go to the hospital, she wanted to be prepared and have a few things that she wanted to have with her. Well, thankfully, she did get better. Even at home, she was trying to stay isolated from me and to help me from not getting sick. And of course, I wasn't very helpful about that. You know, I say, give me a kiss or give me a hug. It was like, please, I'm trying to keep you healthy. But she finally got better and unpacked her little suitcase. And sometime later, we were cleaning up and I was going to put that suitcase away, and I just opened it up to make sure it was empty, and there was one thing that she had left in there, and it was a photo, a family picture, a picture of me and all of our kids and all of our grandkids. I walked downstairs with a tear in my eye, and I said, hey, I found this picture in your suitcase. And she looked at me with a tear in her eye, and she said, "You know, I know that God had this, but it was scary. And I didn't want to be alone. I didn't like the thought that I'd be in the hospital and maybe be alone. I wanted you all with me." You see, when we're afraid, one of the things we do is we want to have the familiar with us. We want to have something that we know or can hold on to. Fear is a part of who we are. That's why I go back to those shepherds, and I kind of love them. There they are minding their own business, and all of a sudden they're frightened because there's an alien being speaking to them that says, "Fear not." And I can almost hear the shepherd saying, "What do you mean, fear not? I mean, fear not. We're out here minding our own business, and we have some beings from another world talking to us. What do you mean, fear not? Why wouldn't we be afraid? Why shouldn't we be afraid? All we have right now is fear to operate on." And there are times in our life where we feel like all that we have is fear. That's all we have to grab hold of is fear. But something about those shepherds and their story. Don't forget that those shepherds, though they were considered to be outcasts from general society, I mean, they were out in the fields for months at a time. They didn't shower, didn't smell very good. But don't forget, they were still Jewish citizens, which means when they were kids growing up, they would have heard the stories about the coming Savior, the Messiah. They would have heard the prophecies about him. They would have heard the different names that he would be called. And I think about this. When they went and saw the baby in the manger, the Bible tells us that when they left, they were totally different. I mean, no more fear. I mean, something had happened to them. And I wondered to myself, is if when they were looking at that baby, maybe they remembered some of the prophetic words that they'd been taught from the prophet Isaiah. When Isaiah wrote these words, "For unto you a child is born, unto you a son is given. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace." Do you realize that anything that you are going through right now, anything that you will go through, anything that you're facing, the things that frighten us or scare us, do you realize that in those four descriptions of Jesus Christ, you have all the hope that you need? Wonderful Counselor. What kind of questions are you trying to get answers for? What are the things that are perplexing to you? Well, you have a Wonderful Counselor. Talk to him. What are the battles that you face? You've got a Mighty God. When you're alone and you feel like, "I'm tired of this loneliness," you've got the Everlasting Father who's present with you. And when your heart is worked up and can't calm it down, grab a hold of the Prince of Peace. All wrapped up in those prophetic words, words that are meant for us. For when you know Jesus, when you recognize him, that baby born in a manger, you have all that you need. You have hope, and you have calm, and you have peace, all wrapped up in those names. I have a pastor friend that shared this story with me. She was asked to sing at a friend's wedding, and so she said yes, and she'd rehearsed and practiced and got things all ready. And the time came for the wedding, and she was now singing. She's up front in front of this church full of people, and she's singing. And the words that she's supposed to sing are these words: "When I met you, all of my hopes and all of my dreams were suddenly fulfilled." She started singing, and she came to that part, and she said this: "I knew the words were wrong, but I couldn't think of the right words, so I decided that I was going to sing out is with emotion and power, even though they were the wrong words." And here's what she's saying: "When I met you, all of my hopes and all of my fears were suddenly fulfilled. All of my hopes and fears suddenly fulfilled." She said, "I felt so horrible." But you know what? She may not have been so wrong. You know, she wasn't the first person to put the words hope and fear together. A guy by the name of Phillips Brooks, back in the 1800s, wrote a Christmas carol, "The Little Town of Bethlehem." It goes like this: "O little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light." Now catch it. "The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight." The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. What does that mean? You see, friends, it goes like this. Hope without an anchor is fantasy. And fear, without anything to counter it, just runs our lives. But when Jesus Christ came, hope came into this world. So hope finally has an anchor, and fear has finally met its match. Whatever you face, whatever you may face, when you realize you have Jesus Christ, all of your hopes and all of your fears are met in Him. One of the great things about Christmas comes every year on December 25th. You say, what does that mean? It means that no matter how bad the year might be, every year ends with Christmas. And Christmas is that mark of hope. And every new year begins with Christmas, the story of hope having an anchor and fear having met its match. Now, if we were together at the church, we'd be having a candle lighting, and we'd end the service with watching those candles be lit and passed throughout the church. Of course, we're not going to do that this year. But we are going to end with Silent Night, and our worship team is going to sing that song, Silent Night. And it's an incredible song. Silent Night has the ability, for like no other Christmas carol, to quiet our hearts, to settle us down. It's a redeeming moment. The busiest of our lives can change when we have this moment of Silent Night in our lives. So we're going to sing that song, and you might want to sing along, or perhaps you instead want to sit there and just having a quiet moment. You see, for some of us, you've had anything but a quiet day. There's no silence in your house. For others of you, the silence is so loud, it's deafening. And yet in this song, Silent Night, you can find hope and find peace. So whether you sing or whether you sit in silence and just listen, enjoy this incredible redeeming moment as we sing this song together, Silent Night.
Oh, Well, that's it. Thank you so much for inviting us into your homes and into your lives on this Christmas Eve. You know, when we began, we showed you some video footage of different things happening, some of the events in the world, but the truth of it is, we're not just watching them, we live in them. And so our hope has been that in these past few moments, you've been able to step out of that world and step into this world, the world where we celebrate the birth of Christ. And perhaps the remainder of your day, whatever you might be doing, you'd be able to get separate from all the other stuff in this world and just celebrate Christmas. From all of us to all of you, Merry Christmas.